I would like to thank very much the organizer for giving me the opportunity to speak. It's a great pleasure and a great honor. And okay.
All right, so as the next speaker, we have Isabel Bouchoul.
Yes, yes. Pleasure.
And we have... It was not meant to pressure.
Oh, shit. Up. Oh, excuse me. Okay, so I will present you some results which were done in my team with my student. No, the pointer doesn't work. Well, whatever. Ah, yeah. Yes, it works, but it's faint. With my student, Maximilian Schemer, in collaboration with two theoretician colleagues, Benjamin Doyon from King's College and Jérôme Dubail from Nancy, who played a very important role in this project. So I will also briefly mention some other experimental results which were done in the group of David Weiss and at Penn State University. Okay, so the topic is out of equilibrium dynamics of a many-body system. So describing the out of equilibrium dynamics from a microscopic description of the system presents a huge complexity. In fact, it's completely untractable. But hopefully, if one is interested only in long wavelength dynamics occurring on long times, then one can rely on an emergent theory, which is the so-called hydrodynamic theory. This theory is very powerful to describe the fluid behavior. For instance, it can describe motion in the atmosphere. And it can also describe many out-of-equilibrium experiments performed in cold atom gases. So this theory assumes local thermal equilibrium. So now, what about systems that would be integrable? Those systems, because of the infinite number of degrees of conserved quantity they host, are known to not to show a priori thermal equilibrium relaxation. So how to describe dynamics in those systems? And this was the subject of a lot of works those last several 20 years, I would say. And it ends up with a theoretical breakthrough, which is the development of a generalized hydrodynamic capable of predicting dynamics in those integrable systems. So it was done in two papers around at the same time in 2016. And this emergent generalized hydrodynamic theory has been tested in cold atom setups. So first in my team, in an atom chip experiment that I will present you, and a bit later by David Weiss in another experiment. Okay, so first I will present you the generalized hydrodynamic theory in a simplified way. And then I will present you my experiment and the validation of this theory we made on our experiment. So finally, I will very briefly present the results obtained in David Weiss' group before concluding. Okay, so before going to the topics really of dynamics, I would like to discuss actually relaxation to equilibrium in a quantum isolated many-body system, because this is really at the heart of the hydrodynamic theories. So let us consider first the case of a chaotic system, like most systems, in fact. And we will consider the simplest case of a single component system whose Hamiltonian is independent on space. So you have conserved quantities on those systems, which are the total atom number, the total momentum, and the total energy in your system. And all of these quantities are actually local in the sense that they can be written as a sum over spatial coordinates of an observable which has a finite spatial extent. So actually, the reaching thermal equilibrium in such system is now something which is well understood within the framework of eigenstate thermalization hypothesis, and I will recall this. So let's consider some state of your system that expands on the eigenstates of your many-body system, and let's consider the mean value of some local observable O. As time goes on, cross-term between different eigenstates, because they oscillate at different frequencies, will give zero contribution. So you will see the mean value of the observable at long times will reach a stationary value. So you have a relaxation phenomena. And the value to which it relaxes is just a weighted sum of the mean value of this observable in the microstates. In the eigenstate. And now comes into play the eigenstate thermalization hypothesis, which tells you that all those mean values, they are actually equal. So in fact, the mean value of a local observable is a smooth function of the total atom number, total momentum, and total energy. So providing the width you explore in energy, momentum, and atom number is small enough, you can consider that all those values are the same. So you find that the mean value the local observable relaxes to is just a function of those three quantities, atom number, momentum, and energy. So we understand thermalization. And the system, after relaxation, I repeat, because it's fundamental, is described only by three quantities, energy, atom number, and momentum. So we can describe the system by any diagonal ensemble that is picked around those three values, and a popular one is the Gibbs ensemble at some given temperature and chemical potential. But the eigenstate thermalization hypothesis is not valid for all systems. This is trivially seen if you consider the case of an ideal gas. In this case, the momentum distribution, of course, is preserved. And the momentum distribution, providing it is coarse grain, is a local quantity. Now you can see easily that you can construct two momentum distributions which have the same atom number, the same mean momentum, and the same energy, so the same three first moments, but which differ strongly, such as the one I plotted here by hand. So this system does not obey eigenstate thermalization hypothesis. It's because it's non-chaotic. In fact, it belongs to the class of integrable systems. Integrable systems, they are characterized by the fact they host an infinite number of conserved quantities, N, P, E, but many other ones, and all of them are local. And in those systems, if they are not too trivial, you will also see relaxation phenomena because of the scrambling out of different phases. But the relaxed state will no longer depend only on three numbers. Instead, those systems, they will obey a generalized eigenstate thermalization hypothesis, which says that the mean value of local observable are actually a function of the infinite set of conserved quantities. So, which means that different eigenstates with the same value of the conserved quantity within some small interval are actually identical as long as local observables are concerned. So we understand now that integrable systems, they will also show relaxation, but to parameterize the state after relaxation, now it's necessary to give all the conserved quantities, so we need to give an infinite number of quantities. And a popular ensemble that can describe the system after relaxation is actually the generalized Gibbs ensemble with as many Lagrange multipliers as you have conserved quantities. Now let us consider, oops, oh no, okay. Let us consider the Liebling-Eger model, which is the model of one-dimensional bosons with contact repulsive interaction. Its Hamiltonian is written here with J, the interaction coupling strength. A very important notion is the notion of rapidities. Rapidities can be defined if one considers an expansion to infinity. So at some time TC, let us consider that you let your system expand to infinity. The momentum distribution of the particles will evolve during this expansion because of interaction, but at very long time, interaction becomes negligible and the momentum distribution will become stationary. And actually, the rapidities are nothing else than the asymptotic momenta of the particles. What is very special about the Liebling-Eger model is that, because of its integrability, the rapidity distribution is a conserved quantity. I mean, it does not depend on the time TC at which you let the gas expand to infinity. Even if you had a very complicated out-of-equilibrium dynamics going on in the system, the distribution of rapidity is preserved. So this built, of course, an infinite number of conserved quantities. In particular, each moment of this distribution is a conserved quantity. The three first ones being atom number, total momentum, total energy, but you have many other ones. So in this system, which is integrable, of course, you will have relaxation, but the state of the system after relaxation is not described by only three numbers, as in a chaotic system, but it's described by a whole function, the rapidity distribution. And we introduce the intensive quantity, which is rho of k, the rapidity distribution per unit length. Okay, now let's go to dynamics. So we will consider dynamics occurring on a typical length scale lambda, which is very large compared to a microscopic length LC, which give microscopic correlation length in your system. And the dynamics will also occur on timescale T, which are much larger compared to the microscopic relaxation time in your system. Because of this separation of scales, you can choose consider fluid cells whose size L fulfilled L much larger than the microscopic length scale, but L much shorter than the size on which dynamics occurs. So because of this, and because the time on which dynamics occur is very large compared to the local relaxation time, you can consider that in each cell, the fluid is well described by a homogeneous fluid that has relaxed. So now what happens if you consider a chaotic system? Each cell is completely described by giving three numbers: the atomic density, the momentum per unit volume, and the energy per unit volume. In fact, the two last quantities, they can be parameterized by the fluid velocity U and the internal energy E. Okay, so now, to describe the gas as a whole, you just need to specify three time and space-dependent functions. So all these three quantities are local values of a global conserved quantity. So it has to obey a continuity equation, which I wrote here. And here, the current here, J, for the conserved quantity small q, is a function of the local property of the gas, so it's a function of linear density, fluid velocity, and internal energy. In fact, here, I neglect terms which would involve spatial derivative of those numbers, but those terms will be negligible for large enough scale. This is the so-called Euler approximation. So under this approximation, we find three equations, which are the well-known hydrodynamic equation. So on the second equation, which gives the conservation of momentum, in fact, I add here the effect of an external potential, which actually breaks the conservation of momentum. And here in the flux of momentum term, here you see that a function appears, which is the pressure, and this one has to be determined by microscopic consideration. Okay, so this is all nice, but now what happens when we deal with an integrable system, and more specifically with the Liebling-Eger model? So now to describe each fluid cell, it's not sufficient to give three numbers. You should specify a wall function, the local rapidity distribution, rho of k. And so that the system as a wall is described now by a two-dimensional function, rho of k and x. And now for each slice in k, you have conservation of the total rapidity number. So you have a continuity equation. So what you get at the end is a formula like this, which is of the form of a Liouville equation. So here again, I add the effect of an external potential, and which is locally simply to make a small translation of the rapidity distribution in the k direction. Okay, now. Here, the flux term has been written in terms of the rapidity density, rho, times some effective velocity. And the hard job now is really to compute this effective velocity. And this is what has been done in those two papers in 2016. And they found a self-consistent equation giving the effective velocity for a given wave vector k. So we find such an equation. It depends, it depends on the coupling constant between atoms, and it depends on the rapidity distribution because it depends on the state of your system. Okay, so this equation might look a bit awful, but in fact, it has a very simple interpretation that I would like to give you. Let us consider just two bosons in 1D with a contact interaction. So you can work out the eigenstate for this system, and you can easily consider the collision of a wave packet centered on some relative wave vector k. And what you will see is that after the collision, the wave packets, they undergo a shift in position, which is given by delta k, whose expression is given here. Now you can go from this two-body picture to a many-body picture. For this, you consider a particle with a wave vector k, and you look at its shift in position per unit times. So each time it undergoes a collision, it suffers from this position shift, and you just have to sum over the number of collisions per unit time. And this gives you the effective velocity. So this is very nice. It enables you to recover this formula by yourself in a few lines. But I would like to warn you that it might give the wrong idea that rapidity, this wave vector, is nothing else than the momentum of the atoms, which is actually not the case. Okay, now let's go to the experimental test of this theory, so in my experiment, the first that has been done. So I use rubidium atoms that are confined magnetically in traps made by current going through microwires deposited on a substrate, the so-called atom chip. So using three wires with alternating with current shown here, you can actually guide the atom on a line along the central wire. And using very small distances, so in my case, I use wires separated by 15 micrometers, but you can get very high magnetic field gradients and high transverse confinement. So in the experiment, I will show you transverse confinement are in the range of a few kilohertz. I also produce longitudinal confinement using wires that are perpendicular and that are shown here. And I use actually four wires, which give me enough degree of freedom to control the four first term of the expansion in power of x of the longitudinal potential. So we can realize a single well potential, harmonic-like, like the black curve here, or we can also realize double well potential, like the red curve you see here. So our chip is covered with a mirror, and here is a picture of it, a photo of it. So this chip is placed under vacuum, and we perform in situ images of our atomic cloud by absorption images. So this is a typical images. You see two clouds, the clouds and its reflection on the mirror. So the number we have are given here as a typical number. So typically, the typical energy per atom is smaller than the transverse energy gap between the transverse ground state and the excited state. So our gas is well described by a 1D gas. And the longitudinal potential we realize are very smooth, so that indeed we can define some cells which are very small compared to the total shape of the cloud, but where the gas is well described by a homogeneous gas. Okay, so the gas we produce initially are actually more or less well described by gas at by a Gibbs ensemble, a gas at thermal equilibrium. And the thermodynamics of the Liebling-Eger model actually was worked out already in the 60s by Yang and Yang, and everything is known, the pressure, the entropy, and actually we can also derive the zero distance two-body correlation function G2 of zero because of Hellman-Feynman theorem. And so we can plot, we can have a phase diagram of this system at thermal equilibrium where we use the dimensionless parameter gamma, which measures the strength of the interaction, which is proportional to G and inversely proportional to the linear density. And theta here is the dimensionless temperature parameter. So in this phase diagram, you see here on this corner, the strongly interacting regime, the so-called fermionized regime, where the G2 function of zero goes to almost zero. But in my experiment, I will stay in the weakly interacting regime, quasi-condensate and also nearly ideal gas regime. So, okay, so now we start from a cloud at equilibrium, and we will initiate out of equilibrium dynamics by suddenly changing the longitudinal potential, V of x. So we would like to test generalized hydrodynamics. So we would like to find the situation where the prediction of generalized hydrodynamics and those of the conventional hydrodynamics are very different. So let us look at prediction of the conventional hydrodynamics. In this description, the gas is assumed to be always described locally by a thermal equilibrium. And the rapidity distribution for a Gibbs ensemble is actually a function which is a smooth function which is single peaked. So if I find a situation where my rapidity distribution at some time and some position becomes double peaked, then for sure it cannot be described by conventional hydrodynamics. And such a situation will occur if I prepare my cloud in a way such that it has two density bumps, and if I let it expand. So here are results of generalized hydrodynamics. So this is a rapidity distribution versus x of the initial cloud, which is double peaked. And this is after some expansion time. So the positive rapidities of the left peak will go to the right. The negative rapidity of the right peak will go to the left. So at some point, it's intuitive to think that in the middle, we will have a double peak rapidity distribution. And this is indeed what happens. So I will realize this protocol in my experiment. So I start with a cloud at equilibrium in a double well potential, such that the density profile shows this double peak structure that you see on the blue curve here. And at t equals zero, I suddenly remove the potential, and then I let the gas expand. So what you see is plot here, with the noisy curve being the experimental data, and the fat lines being the results of generalized hydrodynamics. So we have a very good agreement. And this is the generalized hydrodynamic is the only theory that could explain what we observe here. Hopla. Indeed, if we would insist, if we want to analyze our data with conventional hydrodynamic, this would completely fail. And this is shown here, where I look at the density profile after some expansion time, 40 milliseconds. So you see in fat green line the prediction from generalized hydrodynamic, which explains well our data. And in black dotted line is the results of conventional hydrodynamic. And you see that it completely fails to reproduce the experimental data. So this is even better seen on this slide, where I plot the two-dimensional plot of the rapidity distribution. So the top row is the results of the generalized hydrodynamic calculation. So this is the initial situation after some expansion time, and on the right here for a longer expansion time. And the bottom row is what we expect from conventional hydrodynamic. So here, at each time and at each position, the gas is assumed to be at thermal equilibrium, so the rapidity distribution is single-peaked. And you see, of course, that it's very different. You see, actually, on the right graph at the bottom, that some sharp features begin to appear here on the conventional hydrodynamic. And actually, this will lead, shortly after, to really a shock, a divergence of the density profile. So we also decided to reproduce the famous Newton's cradle experiment, which was first made in the group of David Weiss in 2006, and which actually drove all this field, which ended up with the discovery of generalized hydrodynamic. So to realize a similar setup, we start from our double peak cloud, shown in blue here, and now at t equals zero, instead of removing the potential, we replace it by a harmonic potential, so that the two density peaks, they will go towards each other, collide, and then split again, and so on. And here are the experimental results together with prediction from generalized hydrodynamic, which are in fair agreement. So here, conventional hydrodynamic is completely off. At about 30 milliseconds, it would show a shock, and would give no prediction. Okay, now let's go to a brief description of the results that were obtained soon after in the group of David Weiss, because it's very much related. In his experiment, he has gases which, in contrast to my experiment, lie quite in the strong interaction regime. So the gamma parameter, describing the strength of the interaction, is of the order of one. And he has 1D gases, is very small atom number, actually, only a few tens, like 20. And his temperature is very small. So while in my case, the GHG calculation take into account the initial temperature, in this case, results will be compared to zero temperature GHG. So what he does is that he has his gas confined in a single well potential, and suddenly he increases the strength of the confinement very much, by a factor like 100. So the density profile of the gas, the gas will shrink a lot and then expand again, and so on. And what he measures, in contrast to me, is actually the rapidity distribution itself. He measures this doing a 1D expansion, as I explained before. And in red are his experimental results, together with the GHG prediction in black, and we have a very good agreement. And here, on the small C graph, sorry, my pointer is not working, you see a contour plot of the calculated rapidity distribution from the theory, and you see that at some position it is double peaked. So that indeed you really need GHD. Conventional hydrodynamic would completely fail. So this is another test of GHD in a very different setup. I just would like to mention that here the atom number per 1D gas, yes, because he has actually many 1D gases, but this is a detail, is actually very small. So it's quite amazing, in fact, that GHD, which is a large wavelength effective theory, still works in this situation. Okay, it's okay with time? I'm ready to conclude now. So I hope I convince you that GHD, generalized hydrodynamic, is really a great theory that permits for the first time a description of long wavelength dynamics in integrable system. And I hope I convince you that we validate this effective theory in our experiments. So now there are many possible outlooks. One could look for other protocols, other out-of-equilibrium dynamics. For instance, we can look at the so-called bipartite protocol, where two semi-infinite 1D gases with different temperature or density are put in contact. There are very interesting things to see here, as shown theoretically, but to really see them, it would be highly desirable to implement a measurement of the rapidity distribution that would be local. So this is something we are working on right now. So there have been theoretical work to go beyond the GHG I presented you. And actually, one can take into account terms which of higher spatial derivative terms, which are diffusive correction in the same way as Navier-Stokes. And this has been done by Jacopo De Nardis. And this will lead to a global relaxation of your system that would be described just by the global rapidity distribution. In fact, if you have this dissipative term plus a non-homogeneous longitudinal potential, both stuff can actually lead to a true thermalization towards a thermal equilibrium, because here the spatial variation of the longitudinal potential will actually break the integrability. Finally, I would like to advertise the work we did those last year with Jérôme Dubail also, and for this paper with Benjamin Doyon, on the effect of losses. So we managed to compute the evolution of the rapidity distribution under the effect of losses. And this is actually absolutely non-trivial, so you can have a look in the paper if you're interested. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for a very interesting talk. Are there questions? We are noticing a pattern here.
So you mentioned just in passing that it was kind of remarkable that in Dave Weiss's experiments, that with 20 atoms per tube, that this whole worked. Now let me just make sure that I'm understanding how remarkable this is. If I've understood correctly, the whole idea of the GHD is that you divide your system into some cells, and each one of the cells then gets is thought of as being locally in thermal equilibrium. And now if the whole system is 20 atoms,
yes,
and then you divide it into cells, you figure it doesn't make sense to divide it into less than maybe four or five cells. So then you've got four or five atoms, and that does seem, and this is what you were getting at, right?
Exactly.
This is totally remarkable.
Yes,
okay.
It's totally remarkable, but I would like to say something. If the gas would be very, very deep into the strong interaction regime, then it would be described really, as long as density are concerned, by and rapidity distribution, in fact, which map to the momenta of the fermions, it would be completely described by a gas of non-interacting fermions. And for those one, you have the Liouville equation, which is exact, whatever the number of particles. Uh-huh. It does not rely on a large wavelength. So maybe it's because he is so close, he is quite strong interaction, uh-huh, that actually it works. But he sees in his experiment effect that goes beyond the strong interaction regime. So it's not true that his experiment can be explained purely by free fermions. Otherwise, it would be not so interesting, in fact. Uh-huh. So still it's remarkable, but I won't...
Okay, but the idea that it's sort of close to a fully fermionized system.
Yes, if it would be fully fermionized, then you have Liouville equation, which, okay, is valid, which is not an emergent theory, which is the exact theory.
Okay. Okay, thanks.
Other further questions? Please.
No. Enfin, yes, he has stronger confinement. This is, in fact, a good question. Actually,
Yes, if I understand correctly, please correct me, is how 1D you need to be for this viewpoint to be valid?
Okay, so Jörg Schmidt-Meyer published a paper where he exactly addressed this question. But in his case, actually, he's in the ideal Bose-Gaz regime. So it's not so interesting on my point of view. Plus, the theory he built to describe this, I have some concern about this. So actually, we wrote together with Jérôme Dubail recently a review paper on a GHD, and we discuss this paper. So you can have a look, a closer look. I think I cannot discuss here my issue about this. But we discussed the paper. So it has been addressed in this paper, although I have some concern about this. And I think it's a very, very difficult topic if you want really to address it correctly. And this is, I understood the difficulty of this topic when I was working on the effect of losses. Like just one body losses in a 1D gas, so you just remove atom one by one, it's absolutely non-trivial. It will change the whole rapidity distribution. So this tells you that it will be very difficult to take into account the fact that atoms can change vibrational state. But no, there is no, to my point of view, there is no good theory to take this into account.
Further questions? I want to ask a question. So just for my education, picking up on this idea about the effect of losses, let's say we do that to the conventional hydrodynamics, and now we add losses, different types of dissipation. How much does this wiggly curve that you showed there, how much is that changed, and what can you still exclude if you enhance the conventional hydrodynamics by adding losses, dissipation, and so on? Which would be present in the experiment, right?
Yes, but since what we see is really linked to the fact that at some point in some position in space we have a double peak rapidity distribution, I don't see that losses could save the conventional hydrodynamics.
I'm not sure I want to save it or not, so, but I'm just wondering, let's say you add some dissipation, do they disappear, for example? Does that feature more, go closer to your experiment?
No, I don't think so. Although I didn't do calculation of conventional hydrodynamics, including losses. But this we could do. But in the experiment I show with the expansion, we have barely no losses because the gas becomes more and more diluted as time goes on. In the opposite, in my Newton cradle experiment, the gas gets quite dense at some point. And here, we see on long times substantial deviation with GHD that we interpret as being due to losses. Because here, on this graph I show with the Newton cradle, I lost about 30% of the atoms at the end because I have three body losses each time the cloud gets too narrow.
But would you agree that it would be fair to include them equally in the conventional and the generalized?
Yes, okay. It would be fair. But as I said, in the experiment, when I'm looking at the expansion, actually I don't have losses experimentally, or very little.
Please.
You described what you called a naive picture of the effective velocity.
Yes.
And you emphasized that it's not having to do with the momentum of the particles. Now, what I'm wondering is this the same as something like drift velocity? Like if I think about the velocity of electrons in a conductor that has a current, there's a drift velocity which is much, much smaller than the actual velocities of the electrons. Is it the same kind of thing? Because there's many collisions and... Or is it something different? Sounds like it's something different.
I think it is something different. Because you have to keep in mind that the rapidity distribution is not the distribution of velocity of your particles. It's different.
Yeah. But a drift velocity is also not the velocity of the particles. It's some averaged over lots of collisions and...
Okay, but now you could forget about the hydrodynamic and flux and effective. Just look at the rapidity distribution. If you have in mind this simple picture, you would say, okay, now I have rho of k dk rapidities in an interval dk around k. So I have, so you could think I have rho of k dk atoms at this momentum. But this is not the case.
Okay.
Maybe just...
we'll talk some more.
Okay.
Well, let's thank Isabelle Bouchoux for a wonderful talk. Thanks.